Hi, everybody, and welcome to Paul Listnick Behind the Curtain. It's my opportunity to step away from the worlds of politics and law that you watch me cover on television every day to the world of my wonderfully true passion, that of theater and the arts. And what this is such a special show coming up. I got to tell you, not only will the show be special that these two performers are in, directed by a good friend, but in addition, it's just one of the great shows of all time. So without further ado, we're going to be talking about Sunday in the Park with George in concert, put on by Porchlight Music Theater. Joining us, the stars of this show, Sean Allan Krill, coming home to play George. Hi, Sean. Thanks for being with us. This is your home.
It is, absolutely. I was born and raised, and I mean, I wasn't actually born in Chicago, but I feel like as an actor, I was. I moved there as a very, very young actor and was there for 15 years in Chicago. And I love Chicago so much. I miss it. And I love coming home to work and to see my family and my friends that are like family. So I'm thrilled.
And,
I'm thrilled
and
that
by
Michael,
the way, just,
Michael asked me to do it.
I know everybody knows you, and we're going to get to that with Michael. But I know everybody knows you, but just in case, you just had a phenomenal run on Broadway with Parade, working with Ben Platt in that case. You worked with Ben Platt when he was Ben Platt. I worked with Ben Platt when he was doing Book of Mormon. He wasn't Ben Platt yet.
Little Benny. Yeah,
mini Ben.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And by the way, you were also, I just got to do a shout out for Jagged Little Pill, because that was a show I did not think I would like. I'm going to be honest. And then I loved it.
Oh, so, I'm so glad.
Oh, oh, I just want to see it again and again. So congratulations. And Kathy Voytko joins us. And Kathy, you are a million credit. We do your credits. We're just never going to get through to anything that you're going to come here to do. But I got to point out one thing that I think not only put you on the map, but every, and you know where I'm going, every understudy, every swing, every standby looks at you and says, God, well, God bless you, but God bless Hugh. Oh, that was clever. You, of course, but I want you to tell the story. The shout out you got, I think it was, what, 4 days into Music Man, and Sutton Foster came down ill. And what happened?
Pandemic shutdown times, fourth preview of the Music Man. I was at a costume fitting at 11 in the morning, and about 11:45, I got a call from the stage manager and says, you're on, what do you need? And I said, I need to run the show in order, because they were still changing things during previews. So I didn't know it well enough out of order. So the whole company showed up. We ran it once. We ran Mary and the Librarian, I think, three times, because there's a lot of books being thrown and there are potential projectile situation. And that night I was on. That was my first rehearsal.
You were off book?
Yes. Fortunately, I'm fine to do my homework. I'm a quick study. And I only invited two people to see that show, and they were Sean Krill and Harry Booby.
Oh, my God. Oh, how fantastic.
Right. So I was there. We were there, and it was, she was incredible. It was one of the most incredible things I've ever witnessed, because I've known Kathy for so long. We're dear friends. And I knew that she is this wildly capable performer. I mean, she's a true triple threat. So I knew that she was going to be fine, but I had, you know, you haven't rehearsed something. I mean, what she skipped was because it was COVID, she'd never even been on the stage.
Yes, they had very strict rules. We weren't allowed to even walk the stage. So we didn't really know what the wings looked like. We didn't really know what the sets were all about, because they had all the standbys, swings, and understudies sitting in the mezzanine to keep the numbers backstage low as they possibly could. So that was crazy. I don't recommend it. But Hugh was very kind to shout out. And
have to ask you, that of course, his speech at the end, which was to just praise you to high heaven, which has gone viral. I mean, I don't know anybody who loves Broadway that hasn't seen his speech, but did you know it was coming? Did you have any suspicion?
No. He just said, I'm going to say something afterwards. And I thought he was just going to say, here's my friend Kathy, and she did the show tonight and didn't have any rehearsal. Right. Like, I thought it was going to be short, sweet, but I thought it was ultimate class to bring up every single cover that was on that night, not just me. All of my friends who also had to step in. And I did two more shows, and then two more shows later, we lost so many people that there wasn't even enough people healthy in our cast to have a River City. River City would have been very skinny. So we ultimately had to shut down for 10 days till everybody got back to health. But it was a crazy time. But I'm grateful to you for bringing some light to the swing universe, because a lot of people are like, what the heck is a swing? What does that even mean? So it got the conversation going, and I appreciate him wildly for that.
And people know now. I mean, I really think before COVID, if nothing good came out of it, but if anything good did, the fact that people, at least in the theater community who love theater, grew to appreciate and love understudies. Because now if I go to a show, you know, usually you say, oh, it's an understudy, I don't want to go, right? But now you're like, no, this is an amazing person. This is going to be an incredible performance. By the way, I noticed that Hugh did not point out Sean in the audience. I'm just going to make a point of that.
Oh, I know. We haven't talked since. I'm furious with him.
All right. If he sees this, we'll clear it up. And by the way, I also want to, you know, just to not just give that one credit for you, Kathy, but of course, Oklahoma working with my Patrick Wilson. I've had such a crush on him. He's so great working with him and Andrea Martin and Evita and Phantom. And just both of your records are unbelievable. So Michael Weber, artistic director at Porchlight Music Theater, when you decided to do Sunday in the Park with George, which, by the way, I will be in the audience with my signed copy of Sunday in the Park, signed by Stephen Sondheim and James LaPine. Michael knows I collect some things. And so I will be following along to make sure that Stephen and James are, you know, hearing what they need to hear. But Michael, you came up with the show maybe first. What led you to say, I'm going to go get these Broadway legend types and we're going to just have them do this in Chicago?
Well, one thing that needs to be mentioned is that, you know, Kathy, like Sean, is a Chicagoan.
Yes.
I met Kathy working with her back in the day at the Candlelight Dinner Playhouse, where she was a huge star there. And then, of course, she's been at Marriott and a lot of other Chicago theaters. So Kathy Voytko is somebody whose Chicago audiences have known for years, as long as they've known Sean Krill. And when thinking about this particular piece and producing musicals nowadays, we rarely get that opportunity to hear full orchestrations, especially in the Chicago theater community. To do full productions as they were written, when you're talking about a show like The Music Man, you know, for instance, that originally had probably 25 pieces in the pit back in 1957, audiences rarely get to hear the original orchestrations of a show. And certainly at Porchlight, where our productions are very intimate, when we do our work at the Ruth Page Center for the Arts, we only have 218 seats, and we're usually a larger band for us is probably about 7 or 8 pieces. And I just thought this was a real opportunity to give the audience the occasion of hearing the original orchestrations as they were created in 1984. You rarely get to hear it. And so it shifts a bit of the focus with the audience's experience by going, if you're going to hear that, let's also see those collaborators in making a show. The audience is generally just, you know, enjoying seeing the actors on stage and scenically, but they rarely get to see the understanding that there are two groups of people making music together. So there has been a tradition that really has evolved, certainly with the appearance of like the Encore series in New York at City Center, where audiences have become more accustomed to seeing the orchestra on stage and having that wonderful synergy of seeing actors completely giving over to inhabiting a role, but also having that meta experience of understanding that this sort of using of our imaginations to just believe what we're seeing on stage is sometimes enhanced by also seeing all of the artists present on stage, making that story happen and collectively agreeing with the audience that we are going to pretend that we are right now in the 1800s in France, and this is Georges, and this is Dot, and this is their story. So when you commit to that approach, you also need to be very mindful of who are going to be your actors. And so you start with saying who would be really not only exciting actors, but thrilling actors to see play these roles. When you go to the theater and you're going to see a star, and the star is on that night, when you're seeing Mandy Patinkin, when you're seeing Bernadette Peters, back in the day, Carol Channing, Robert Preston, and they're on Hugh Jackman, and he's on tonight, there's a thrill about that. So I'm being mindful to go, who are actors who audiences can go, oh my God, those actors playing these roles. And the two people who we're sitting on the Zoom with are those types of people. When it comes to Chicago, when it comes to Broadway, they have more than an A game. They are bringing something that you go, this is going to be a unique, inspiring, one of a kind interpretation, and then putting them together opposite each other. Now, they've had a long history with each other as friends, as you know. Sean's the only one that Kathy called to say, come and see me, my pal. I want you to see this. Really, this could be a train wreck. It could be fabulous. And it's fabulous. You know, so now putting them together in two of the best written roles in the music theater canon and doing it at one of Chicago's most beautiful theaters, the Studebaker Historic Theater, with the full orchestra on stage playing those. That's to me now an event. It's not just doing a show. We've created a gift for Chicago, which is an event. And that's what I think that this is going to be.
And one follow. And by the way, Kathy, my apologies. I should have mentioned the Chicago Ties. That was so often to my Music Man understudy story that I just got all
not
caught
at
up
all.
With it.
I got my equity card with Michael Weber at Candlelight. So
wow, because I had to give him money for mine. How did you have?
Michael, it was crazy for you. It was a lot of tap dancing. You know,
we were doing crazy for you. Yeah.
Michael, one more follow-up on Studebaker, because I was going to ask you this. You know, you could have rented out an AMC theater, I suppose, to do this. But one of the things I love about the fact that you're going to the Studebaker is you are indeed, I think, you are in a theater that will give us the Art Institute original painting 1800s feeling here. Was that part of your decision-making?
Well, I think that, I mean, it's a wonderful coincidence that the Studebaker is just literally a walk up to the street to go see the actual painting itself. The thing about the Studebaker is that there are very few Broadway scale houses left in Chicago. Back in the day, the Loop and the South Loop was a plethora of playhouses and burlesque houses and movie theaters that had vaudeville and all of this. You really only have two of those original theaters still in existence, and that's the Merle Reskin, which was originally the Blackstone. Actually, the former Schubert is one of those houses, and the Studebaker. And the Studebaker, you know, I mean, Spencer Tracy, Katharine Hepburn, the Marx Brothers, Bob Hope, amazing people came through on national tour going all the way back to the 20s on the Studebaker stage. And it has sat for years in mothballs. And there was a whole new team who has now taken it over and refurbished it. And I know you've been there, Paul. For any Chicago audiences who've not been able to get into that house, it's sort of like in on Broadway now when they've recently reopened the Hudson, which had been padlocked for years. And then now people have gone in and went, oh my God, this has been sitting here just dormant. And that's what the Studebaker is now. People walk in and go, I had no idea this gorgeous theater had been just sitting in mothballs. And it's got, you know, the old show boxes and you know, it's a full theater with a fly system and orchestra pit, the whole thing. It's a special, special place. And,
yeah,
the audience is, you know, if you've not been there, you're in for a treat.
I can't wait. And by the way, all historical questions get directed to Michael. I think you all know that. Sean, let me come back to you. And, you know, a couple of things I'm going to put together here. First of all, you're not new to Sunday in the Park. You did this, I think, in 2002, Shakespeare?
I did it in 2002 at Chicago Shakes. I played the soldier. And then I did it again in 2012. I went up to Skylight and played George.
Yeah. One of the things I think is amazing, and the fact that Michael said Studebaker across from the Art Institute, I'm sort of curious, when I think of the painting, Sunday in the Park with George, I always forget the French part, but La Grande Jatte. Did both of you go see the painting recently or, you know, soon to kind of remind yourself? And the thing I love, Sean, is this may be one time making life easy for Michael, although it's in concert, but the painting is the stage. The painting is the set.
Right. Right. It really is one of my favorite parts of doing this show is that it's, There's this legacy that Surratt has with this beautiful, beautiful painting, and everyone is very familiar with it. And what is so intriguing about the way the show is built is that you don't get to really see it until the curtain drops on act one, but you're watching little bits and pieces of this thing that you're very familiar with. And, you know, you see the two Celestes and the soldiers, and you see the little girl and the boatman and
the monkey. Don't forget the monkey.
The monkey. I almost said the monkey, but I was like, do you see that? You don't really see the monkey.
I saw the monkey.
Yeah. The monkey just comes out of nowhere and suddenly the dog has a monkey. And it's just so thrilling the way that they've built it, because you don't get to see it in completed until the very last moment of act one. And it's true. You're right. It is, the entire set is the painting, is the island of Le Grand Jatte. And it really is this beautiful world you get to step into. I'm so thrilled to see how we're, you know, in a concert version, how we are going to do that. But as you pointed out, I'm now so excited about doing it in the Studebaker, because I've never seen the theater since it's been refurbished. So I'm just so thrilled now. And you made me so excited, Michael, about doing it with a full orchestra. I mean, I knew that that was happening, but it's really wonderful to be reminded about how it's so beautiful and lush. And then it gets into act two with all that 80s stuff, and it's going to be a blast.
And let me take that to Kathy. We'll say this again, but by the way, if people are wondering, when is this thing? This is May 11th and May 12th. It's 2 days only. And so not a lot of time to see it. This is a really special event. And I think a significant fundraiser, right? For Porchlight, Michael. I mean, I think it's being seen
this, as the this isn't, event. I mean, we're always happy to take donations, but this particular show is not a fundraiser. It is being presented as one of our full productions, but it is being adjusted because, as I said, we normally work in a very intimate environment. That's the mission of Porchlight, to be working generally in about 250 seats or less. The Studebaker is a 600 seat Broadway scale house, but it's very intimate, as frequently Broadway theaters are. We think of at some of the larger theaters where we see a tour of a show, which are 2,000, 3,000 seats. But generally, some of your regular Broadway houses or Broadway tour houses tend to be far more intimate in scale.
Yeah.
And so the audience will have a very close relationship that they've come to appreciate at Porchlight with this show. It's just that it's a little bit bigger environment, because we're going to have the full orchestra right there on stage.
I can't wait. And those boxes, I think I'm going to be in the box. We'll see. So Kathy, let me come to you now. I haven't yet asked the question, what is this show about? Because there are people watching us and listening to us right now who maybe don't know the show. So I'll give that to you, but with an extra touch to it, which is Sean said at the end of his question, and then of course there's act two that takes us into the 80s. What is fascinating about this show is what Sondheim and LaPine did was to literally take two periods of time, thematically merge them, to realize just how similar those eras can be. But talk to me about the plot and the fact that we are crossing time between act one and act two.
Well, I think that the most interesting thing about the plot to me is just the struggle to create art that means something, that will last, and that will speak to a broad audience or a specific audience. And they ask those questions. They have many different conversations about it, and some are not kind, and some are lovely, and some are inspiring. And I think that that is what makes Sunday in the Park with George interesting to me, is that art shouldn't be everyone feels exactly the same way. And I love that LaPine and Sondheim said, you know what, nobody does feel the same way, and that's fine. And I love that they have the introduction of pointillism, and then they, in act two, they suggest that the George is the great grandson of George Seurat, and he's got his own artistic style that he is also struggling with, and people might not understand. And the way that they marry the time period, that art isn't easy, it is never easy, but it always means something to the artist and hopefully to the viewer.
Art isn't easy, but it sure didn't stop Streisand from changing the lyrics. Michael, let me come to you to talk somewhat about the music. I have this theory. I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but there is only one person to ask, and that's Michael Weber. I have this feeling that when it comes to Stephen Sondheim and LaPine, but when it comes to Stephen Sondheim, I feel as though years ago, there was not the appreciation for the theater god that I think he's recognized to be today. It's almost as though when we lost him, people went, Sondheim, well, he's the best. Am I right that even, I mean, I saw Sunday in the Park with George in on Broadway with Patinkin and with Bernadette Peters. I thought it was amazing. But am I right that maybe in the prime of his life, people didn't realize just how phenomenal he was?
With very few exceptions, and that would include Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum and the original production of A Little Night Music, almost every single one of Sondheim's shows was a commercial flop. He did not make the kind of money in his life that Jerry Herman made with just having Hello Dolly and Maine. That set Jerry Herman for life in terms of multiple productions happening over the course of years. It is really that when the reviews shows like Putting It Together, Side by Side by Sondheim, or any number myriad of people who created Sondheim cabarets and took the songs, or Barbra Streisand, who took the songs out of context and then presented them in an easily digestible way. Did the songs then on those occasions register with people? So when they went back later to see revivals of shows, i.e. Merrily We Roll Along on Broadway right now, which in its original production lasted 16 performances, and now it is one of the biggest hits on Broadway and completely embraced by audiences, and it hasn't really changed that much. It took a while for people to digest Sondheim. He was a visionary. He was so far ahead of his time. He was the Shakespeare of our time, and we were living in his time. And so this relates in a way to somebody like Georges Seurat, who was, again, scientifically coming up with a method of painting, and by science, literally using the science of putting two colors together and then putting you at a specific distance where your eye would then merge the colors to create another color. And then when you multiply that times multi-thousands of colors, your eye is working methodically with the painting technique. And so this was looked at by many of his contemporaries, some who refused to even be seen in the same art gallery while his horrible, goofy pieces of art were hanging. I won't have my work hanging in the same gallery with this junk. And now we recognize it as revolutionary. But Mozart never made any money in his life, in his time. How many painters, how many composers in their lifetime were not recognized when their initial works went out? Sondheim at least was able to be given the gift of time that allowed him to see the renaissance of himself, so that by the time he died, he was considered one of the great, great people of the theater. But when his shows were going out and Hal Prince and he were putting together things like Follies, they were losing money hand over fist. It was very difficult to raise money to justify after something like Passion that just was not interesting to Broadway audiences, who are predominantly tourists who want to see Mamma Mia, who want to see the latest revival of whatever's, you know, the hit show with a television star in it.
Right.
So to your point, yeah, he had a challenging go of it.
I saw Passion 4 times. I wanted to see Passion.
And you've done Passion, you know, and you know
that's right.
What an incredible piece that is. But trying to sell that to a commercial audience on Broadway,
yeah,
you know,
it was tough. Well, then Kathy, were you in the show when Greg Edelman was in it, my friend?
No, I did it at Chicago Shakes.
Oh, that, okay, just here. Okay,
but maybe on Broadway too. I saw it on Broadway 4 times, though. I had just moved to New York, and I couldn't get enough of it.
Yeah, amazing. Sean, let me come back to you and return to the painting, because one of the things that also strikes me about the Seurat painting, Michael's given us so much of it, but when you think about it, and Michael, if you haven't cast the monkey yet, I will do it.
I'm talking to Chris Kattan.
Oh, is he coming? Okay, that's good. You know, the thing is, Sean, when we see the characters as Sondheim and LaPine develop them and such, the interesting thing is we have no idea who these people were, right? I mean, Seurat painted this. These people are whoever they are. And these stories have to get created in his head of who are these women? Who are these men? Who are they? Was that something you found fascinating as you have seen the painting, but also having done the show before, that we actually were making up the stories? We have no idea. But I'm sure these were real people that were there at some point.
Right. Of course, they were real people that he probably saw over a course of, who knows, years, you know, a couple years going to the island and painting every day or sketching and then putting it into the final painting. It's one of my favorite parts of what LaPine and Sondheim did, though, is the decisions that they made for each character in the painting and who they are and what their relationships are to each other, what their relationships are to him. And, you know, there's no historical truth, I believe, to the fact that there was a romance between George Seurat and a woman that's in that painting. But the story that they wrote, that they created, is one of the most compelling and romantic and beautiful and heartbreaking things that you can ever watch in musical theater. It's one of the reasons that the show has lasted so long. And then all of it, and you see it all mirrored in Act Two as well. Like all of that stuff with Jules and his wife Yvonne, and those are the critics that we meet, you know, in the putting it together scene at the top of Act Two. It's all those people going, George, what is this? This, you know, this laser thing you're doing. This is so new and weird. That's exactly what Jules and Yvonne are doing. Oh, the dog. You know, I mean, you know, they're just so. They really did truly make this painting come to life in such a beautifully theatrical way, and it really is delightful to step into it in any capacity. I've always said there are two shows that I like at the drop of a hat I would be in no matter what, like Into the Woods, Sunny in the Park with George. Yes, I'm there. Whatever you want me to do, it is a delight. It was one of the greatest experiences of my life to play the soldier at Chicago Shakes. In that production that was directed by Gary Griffin, I was so bonded with those people. We had such a glorious experience that show. It felt like such an honor every day to be a part of that painting. And then the way that they pull George, the character of the actual creator of the painting, into the story and into the painting. Because it's really weird. Sometimes you look at the painting and you're like, oh, right, he's not in it. But if you know the musical, if you're a big fan of the musical, it's like you kind of expect to see him. But he's not there. But he is, you know. And it's just because he's all over it. The whole technique, it wouldn't exist if it weren't for him. The way it was painting, like Michael pointed out, it was just such a new fangled way of doing, of creating color and light and using color and light to sort of thrill the viewer in a way that hadn't been done before.
By the way, isn't it interesting that people probably think when they go and see that painting in the Art Institute, they think that the story of this play is actually what is going on in the painting, how LaPine and Sondheim have now affected that people's experience with the painting. They think that it's biography when it's fiction. And I think, like, you know, it's like the movie Titanic, that people think that Jack and Rose were really like members of that story. And it's,
and
like
she really threw him off that piece of wood.
Yeah, right. That it's right. Not, but you know, a great artist like James Cameron has now affected people's impression of that thing, that moment. Because right. because their artistry of the storytelling and the fiction that they created has had such an impact that people think, oh no, that's Dot and that's Jules and that's, and it's like, no, it's not.
I mean, I'm sure they must have done their research, right? I mean, I'm sure it's all based, Titanic as well, like it's based in archetypes and what would have happened if these archetypes coexisted in the same space. So I'm sure they did their research of like, who would that woman be? Would she be a woman of stature? Would she be... Yeah. These are clearly women that are, or a man who is, you know, a blue collar kind of worker person. He's got a pipe, you know, and so they just riffed on it, and it's absolutely.
Well, and Kathy, I was going to ask you, speaking of the character, I was going to ask you, Dot, Marie, talk to me about, I mean, I don't know what kind of homework one can do for those, but how did those characters get created in your head in terms of who these women would have been? Or, yeah, because they probably, they existed too.
Well, I think that the biggest clue that they give us to who Dot is the fact that she is not particularly good at reading, but she desperately wants to be. So she's just somebody at the time who's using what she has to get what she needs with all the tools at her disposal. And so she's always trying to better herself, but clearly this is just a lovely lady who has not had much schooling, but knowing that George is so fascinating inspires her to get her brain up to snuff, if you will. And I think that they give you many clues like that of who these people are. And I think that we can all relate to that even still today. Like there is nothing, it's very universal in that I want to better myself because this person is inspiring me to do better. And I think that those themes that play throughout the show keep coming around, or even just like the flings that they throw out there amid with all the people in the painting and the eye winking and the what's happening there. And there's just a lot of universal themes that don't really need a time period that are always the human experience. And I think that that is something that you were saying that Sondheim was not appreciated particularly in his time. And I had the blessing to work with him on three different projects, and nobody had a better sense of humor about himself than he did. So I think that it's always interesting to see how we all interpret his words. And I would love for him to be in the room laughing at us interpreting.
did you always, by the way, did you always freak? Everybody I know who's worked with him has always said, but when he was there and when he was in the room, it was freak out time for the cast.
No, that was not the case for me during the Frogs at Lincoln Center. Because he was so casual about it. Like, we can cut that if it doesn't work. We'll just write something else. Like, he was so ready. He wasn't one of those people who said, no, I wrote it and it's perfect and it's done. That wasn't him. He was like, yeah, I can change. And there was one night, as a matter of fact, he gave us all, I don't know, four or six different stanzas of lyrics that we had, Sondheim lyrics, that we had already memorized. He said, will you guys try these tonight? And we went like, what? Tonight? And we actually had the stage manager tape them to the set because we couldn't memorize them as fast as you
want. Ah, the secrets of the stage. And before I lose, we only have a minute left. And Michael, by the way, I have another theory. You're my historian. The name Dot. I always thought that was a humorous homage to his painting style.
I have no doubt that that is possibly one of those things. Why not? You know, LaPine is a pretty clever guy. And that's the thing, you know, particularly with somebody like Sondheim, John Weidman and Arthur Lawrence and all of the people, his other collaborators. Sondheim was always very specific to give credit, even though we say Stephen Sondheim's fill in the blank, you know, right. He had collaborators who were also writing those books with him, George Firth. And you know, and that sounds like something certainly that might have come out of LaPine's mind.
I'd like to think that.
Let's call her Dot.
Well, you know, Kathy and Sean, I have to tell you that every time Michael does anything at Porchlight, my comment is, I never thought he could top what he did last time, but I have a feeling that Sunday in the Park with George is about to top everything for a whole host of reasons. The show is playing at the Studebaker Saturday, May 11th at 7:30, Sunday, May 12th at 2 p.m. Tickets at Porchlight Music Theatre, spelled the proper British way, TRE.org. Look, I've been looking online. There's some seats left. There ain't a lot of seats left. So folks who are watching this, listening to it, please check it out. My thanks to all of you. Thank you for your time. This is going to be so exciting. When I see you, I'll tell you the real interaction between Ansel Elgort and Sondheim.
Mm-hmm. So thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
All right. Thank you, guys. We'll see you at the show. Break legs.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.